Xbalanque! Welcome back to another Casual's Guide to Smite. I'm your host, Sonato, and this week we'll be taking a look at... How the fuck do you say this?
Xbalanque, 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 Xbalanque,
Xbalanque, Xbalanque.
So out of all the five classes in the game, I personally find Hunters to be the most boring to play. But that's mainly because they don't fit my playstyle. All they do is throw out basics like BAP! Riveting gameplay, everybody. Against real opponents, my aiming usually sucks ass, and that's like the most important skill to have with Hunters. I also love characters with good sustainability, and there are basically no Hunters who highly specialize in that. Okay, Neith, maybe. Chiron, kinda sucks. I know Cupid has sustain, but who the fuck wants to play Cupid? Look at this bitch! He's hideous! But one of the few Hunters I've ever had fun with and was decent enough to get to rank 10 with was Xbalanque himself. Until his ass got nerfed for nothing. I swear, his ult was so fun to use, but now it sucks. It has its uses, but I'll get to that later. Xbalanque is a high mobility hunter with great mid to late game damage. Thanks to the change to his passive on May 15th, 2018, he was able to get to his proper damage output during mid game instead of having a jackass Thanatos execute your potential passive point. Potential passive... Triple P! You know what else is triple H? What the fuck do I mean by that? Xbalanque is triple H!
It's all about the game, and how you play it.
Can't play this for copyright reasons. Give me a second. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1, kick it. Till you feel it, y'all. Get down, y'all. Till you feel it, y'all.
Montage time!
Xbalanque's first ability is what gives him the nickname, the hardest hitting hunter. It's called Branching Bola.
Branching Bola. Branching Bola.
And yes, I know I skipped his passive, and I'll get to that in a minute, but that segue though! This ability is a toggled self-buff that will only go away upon death, deactivation, or running out of mana. So my point is, always have this active. While active, Xbalanque's basic attacks cost up to 17 mana per shot, and deal up to an additional 50 damage at max rank. After a buffed Branching Bola, triple B if you will, hits an enemy, two more bolas will branch off behind them in a cone shape up to 30 units and dealing 35% damage to targets hit. So this allows you to hit gods who are being little bitches and hiding behind their wave of minions. And if you build Odysseus' bow, you will wave clear in no time while simultaneously poking the enemy team. You can max this ability out first, but from what I've seen through research and other players is that maxing out your 2 is the way to go. I personally believe that if you can land your basics, unlike me, maxing the 1 first is better for the early game damage.
It is wise to start off with a point in Branching Bola.
Your other abilities are nice and can secure kills, but they have more uses than just damage output. Point is, you're going to be holding down the left mouse button for a majority of the game. Now, I know I said earlier that I suck at aiming, so I'm kind of contradicting myself when I say I love this god, because he really only uses basic attacks and has zero base sustain, but to that I say... Backtracking now, Xbalanque's passive is called Dead of Night. For every 1500 damage Xbalanque deals after mitigation, he gains a potential passive point stack of 5 physical power. This maxes out at 6 stacks, giving him plus 30 permanent physical power. This also adds to his hardest hitting hunter name. Whenever you hit someone, they scream harder daddy, and you must always oblige. Having base bonus physical power always helps, especially when you're a main damage dealer. Since this has to build up, and the fact that you're a hunter, of course your peak is during late game. But occasionally you can get fed early and completely destroy mid game. This passive used to stack for every kill you got, but I assume due to it being inconsistent, they changed it to the amount of damage you dish out. This was a very nice change, although it sucks when you pop off early game and get a triple kill and end up with nothing. But now you're at least guaranteed to always be able to max out your passive every game rather than constantly getting your kill stolen or never being able to finish off a slippery Loki. And speaking of which, Xbalanque's second ability is called Poison Darts, or as I like to call it, Lovely Loki Locator.
Gotcha, bitch!
Upon activation, Xbalanque shoots out 10 poison darts in a large cone shape in front of him, each one dealing up to 90 damage at max rank plus 40% of your physical power. A single enemy can be hit by up to 3 darts, but only takes full damage from one. The other two deal only 30% damage. In the upcoming Talons of Tyranny patch on March 23rd, 2021, the amount of darts that Xbalanque shoots will be increased to 15, and the amount an enemy can be hit by will be increased to 5. After an enemy is hit by a dart, they are poisoned, taking 30 points of damage at max rank plus 10% of your physical power every 0.5 seconds for the next 3 seconds.
minions,
while poisoning the enemy is also slowed by a base 20%. This ability just helps apply pressure and is pretty helpful in teamfights, but the main use of this that I have discovered is to track down invisible assholes. Loki, the Morgan, Izanami, Sir Kay, Jormungandr.
Why the fuck does Jormungandr turn invisible?
They can all be easily found through your darts. It covers such a large area and it's
fast as fuck, boy.
Loki turns invisible, shoot out your darts, and if he walks towards you, odds are he'll get hit. Now this script was first written late last year, so originally I wrote in the script that, yes, I understand Loki doesn't become revealed after taking damage, but the numbers from the tick damage afterwards will help you sniff him out. Still true, but Hi-Rez was like, nah fam, let's make it easy as hell to track him. So now you can find him through the tick damage as well as the silhouette that pops up whenever he is damaged, which now just makes it easier to see what direction he's going. If you can track him down and land at least one basic, then he'll probably retreat. The other aforementioned gods become fully revealed after taking damage, so all you gotta worry about is landing your darts. The slow from the poison helps you hunt down runaways, and the extra tick damage sometimes grants you kills that you didn't even know you wanted. As said before, you can max this ability first rather than your one if you'd like. It's honestly a personal preference, but I've been doing it a lot lately and it helps more than you realize. Xbalanque's third ability is called Rising Jaguar, also known as the Jazzy Juke Jump. After using this ability, you are automatically free of all worries, for whatever the fuck was about to bite your dick off is now sitting there face slamming F6. Upon activation, you dash forward and jump into the air, shooting darts in all directions, dealing up to 280 points of damage at max rank, plus 50% of your physical power. Now this ability has a combo. Any enemies hit by this who were previously poisoned by your 2 take an additional 30% damage. I know this is super tempting at times, but keep in mind that this is also one of the best escapes in the game. This may seem like a combo you want to go for whenever you can, but you only want to use this ability to finish someone off or get the fuck out before you get gangbanged. Cool thing about this ability though is that you can move while in the air, so you can dash in, get the hit off, and basically levitate backwards to get out of harm's way. But Sinato, how is this the best escape in the game? Because while you are in the air, you become immune to all forms of crowd control. You can juke a Hades, you can juke an Ares, you can juke Daji. As long as you're not suffering from
crippling depression,
you can juke anything in the game with the right timing. Though keep in mind that you do still take damage while in the air, so don't be a dumbass and jump straight into a triple case alt. You know, I didn't do so well in that last game. I think we need to study up on Xbalanque's lore, you know, get into the mind of the hunter. Alright, here it is.
Is one of the hero twins Xbalanque and his...
Wait, his brother's name is Hunapu? What?
Hunapu.
Wait a minute, they had to fight the Lords of Death with blowguns and fucking violent ballgame pits? They fought a giant bird named Macaw. Oh shit, this dude go hard though. Motherfucker's got a grill. After knocking out several of his teeth of jewelry, they got some old people to pose as dentists? They replaced his teeth with corn and the bird just freaking died from embarrassment. What the fuck is this lore?
Why did that work?
Xbalanque's ult is called Darkest of Nights, or as I like to call it, Dank Dark Defying. Bullshit! It's useless! And before you Xbalanque mains start whipping out your dicks under your keyboards to complain, only managing to hit the spacebar because of lack thereof, let me explain. Once activated, Xbalanque shrouds all enemies in the game into darkness, blinding them beyond a small radius for 3 seconds. During that time, his basic attack range is increased to 40 feet, and he gains movement speed to up to 60%. That's it.
But what do you mean that's it? That's a lot!
No it isn't!
It's not enough. It's nothing compared to what it was. Before the Xbalanque Massacre of May 29, 2019, this ability was capable of stunning the entire enemy team if they were moving at the end of the ability.
And now that's gone! So chasing became a fuck ton more difficult, and the only use of this in a team fight is the fact that it blinds the enemy team. Yes, the basic attack range bonus is nice, and you can hit structures from outside their radius, which is lit as fuck.
Yes, you're very smart. Shut up.
But that's only helpful late game when you can actually pack a punch, and when those structures are already gone. Also, you do less damage to structures if none of your minions are in its radius, so why bother? This ult can help chase, but the extra range means that it's harder to aim. You either have to be really good at aiming and judging where enemies will run to, or the enemy team has to be filled with a bunch of mindless fuckwits running in a straight line. The movement is fantastic for escaping, don't get me wrong, but for chasing, Yeah, it can get you in range, but Haste of Vitalis is gone, so you're still gonna get screwed over by your basic attack movement penalty. Now, you can still use the Haste passive from Atlanta's bow, but you're gonna have to get a kill before getting its effect. Frostbolt Hammer could definitely help if people are getting away too easily, but there are just better items Xbalanque can utilize. And may I remind you, this only lasts for 3 seconds. So if it's just you versus another, it's useless till you make it to late game, because it does nothing for your basic attacks but make them go further. Though it is really nice getting a snipe to finish off a runaway.
I like it, Kudgy.
But it doesn't add any attack speed, so in the early game, you'll get like 2 shots off before it runs out. However, throughout the whole game, it can help set up plays for your team since the enemy won't see what's coming. But without a team, it's not that helpful. Though in case you didn't know, this does hide you and your team from the minimap as well, so wards are basically disabled during the ult's duration, which can make for some pretty sneaky plays. Then again, it straight up alerts everyone that something is going down. That's mainly why I like to utilize it as a scare tactic. Seriously, just go into a game of arena, activate this ult, and watch everyone back the hell up. IQ level 1000. Beforehand, this ult was on a 110 second cooldown at all ranks, but thankfully, they reduced it to 90 seconds. Now, is this the worst ult in the game? No, far from it. It still has its uses, but from someone who played him for years, it just doesn't feel the same anymore. Not gonna lie though, it was kind of funny seeing everyone after the nerf stop at the end of Xbalanque's ult due to muscle memory, and then seeing it slowly fade out. Also, that's a good way you can spot a returning player who doesn't keep up with patch notes. But seriously though, I just don't understand why they would remove the stun from the ability. I mean, sure, it was able to turn the tide of the game, so what? Not if you had good timing. If you knew how to play against him, it was easy to counter. And from my experience, it was never that bad. Sure, at the time I only played arena and joust exclusively, but I feel that I had enough experience under my belt to be able to tell whether or not something was broken. And while we're on that subject, why don't we talk about Tiamat and her 11 abilities? Hi-Rez, what the fuck? He also has a pizza skin now. Huh. So what if you're on the opposing end? How do you counter Xbalanque? Simple. Build anti-hunter. If they build crit, spectral armor. Most Xbalanque players will most likely build attack speed instead of crit, so counter it with things like Midgardian mail or witchblade. I would say do both to fuck with them, but the CEO of Hi-Rez is a hunter main, so attack speed slow items no longer stack. Instead of doing a counter build, you could also just build full damage and attempt to blow them up before they can get some hits in. Hide a Nemean Lion isn't nearly as good as it used to be.
Thanks a lot, Stuart!
But it's still extremely helpful. And Thorns, for some fucking reason, got nerfed to where you can't activate it while under CC.
Artemis mains! Rejoice!
But the damage reflect is still good. If Xbalanque engaged with this leap and you're full on health and mana and 3 levels ahead of him, fuck him up. Make him realize the mistake he made. Xbalanque also only becomes CC immune during said leap when he's in the air. He is not CC immune while dashing beforehand, so a cripple effect from something like Poseidon's Whirlpool will catch him. Xbalanque is more of a late game hunter, but he does have early game potential. Do not let him get fed early game. You will regret it. Don't take chances against him. If you're low on health, kick a shit in as soon as possible and you'll be fine. Same goes for any other hyper carry. Now for building Xbalanque, here's the generic order. Start out with either Gilded Arrow or Mana Conceptor. Just depends on whether you care more about damage or mana consumption. Speaking of which, mana consumption with your one can be a huge pain in the ass. So build Transcendence. If you're feeling a little spicy, rush it.
Boy.
The extra power it gives you is amazing. Then build Ninja Tabi for the movement and attack speed. Afterward, I usually go with Odysseus Bow. I explained before that it helps poke the enemy while clearing lane at the same time, but the main reason you build it is for the 40% attack speed stat and the fact that it helps you build stacks on Transcendence a hell of a fast. You can also just get Charged Bow, which is a second tier item of this, and finish it later in the game. It has the same passive, but does half the damage and gives half the attack speed, but it's not that bad for 1200 gold. The rest of the build is dependent on the state of the game. If you need or want lifesteal, which I highly recommend since he has no base sustain, get Aussie. It gives a good amount of lifesteal, even more attack speed, power, and even pin. For other penetration items, I definitely recommend things like Dominance and Executioner over things like Titan's Bane, because Xbalanque is obviously not ability focused. Although I have tried that and it is not good. Might try again with the buffs he's been getting lately. To top off the build, crit always works. I don't recommend going full crit because it's not really necessary. It doesn't even need crit to be honest, but if you must build it, go with either Wind Demon or Deathbringer. Fail not works too because it will, not fail. Ha! Anyway, that about wraps it up. If you enjoyed the video, consider liking, sharing, and subscribing. Also, go check out my last 2 videos where I covered Chuck and Aphrodite. And stay tuned for the next god on A Casual's Guide to Smite. Till then, see you on Sonato.